We're in the middle of a series. We've been talking about crucial moments. We kind of titled the series, but it's about how God shapes our lives in different seasons that we go through. And I know I kind of started it in the new year thinking, well, this is kind of when we make adjustments and shifts. And now we're getting near the end of January, and I find myself still making adjustments and shifts to try to get into the best year that we can possibly get. And I believe that in John 10:10, Jesus says, "I have come that you might have life and have it to the full." And to have a rich, full life happens as we partner with God. And that the different sort of seasons that life throws us give us different opportunities and different challenges. And so last week we talked about that opportunity that we all love to be in a place of great scarcity and to not have enough, and how that kind of can be an opportunity for God to do some stuff. And now we're going to flip that coin over and look at what happens in seasons of abundance and how do we make the most of the seasons when we find ourselves with a lot. When I think of abundance, the first thing that comes into my mind is when I moved here from California originally, we popped up here and there was blackberries everywhere. And we would walk down the street, me and my mom would walk down the street, we'd bring Tupperware because there were like blackberry bushes that were overflowing over people's fences and on the sidewalk, and you could just pick them. And it was the best berries we'd ever had because California didn't really have berries to speak of that were very good except for strawberries. And so we thought this was awesome. And so we thought it was so cool that we decided to cut some branches as we were going along the street and plant them in our backyard so that we didn't have to go for a walk to get these things. And they had such an abundant crop. It was fantastic for that first year. And then the abundance began to overflow, and we noticed that the blackberries really could produce a lot and take over nearly everything. There is, in abundance, fantastic blessings, fantastic good things that come into our lives. There is also a tendency for abundance to become something in and of itself that pushes out some other things. And so we're going to look at that and kind of poke into what abundance does. The American dream, in a lot of ways, something that is lifted up is to have a massive abundance. And I like to think more holistically than just financially, because I think that's a very narrow way of looking at the world, but abundance can be an abundance of time. I had a season, it was a really weird season. I was a temp worker in downtown offices, and all of a sudden there wasn't as many jobs to be had. It was kind of when the tech boom went. And I found myself with an abundance of time. And it didn't feel like abundance because there wasn't an abundance of paychecks going on, but I did have this extra resource. And depending on how I navigated that, it could have been a really rich time or not. And I experienced both sides of that. I think of the abundance of friends. There's been times when I've been surrounded by a number of great people. And you go, man, you're just kind of sitting there going, how is it that I'm surrounded by these great people in my life? And I'm blessed that way. And how do we make the most of that instead of just sitting back and going, that's cool. And so there's all sorts of different types of abundance that we can come into. Jesus, I don't think, favored times of, or people with scarcity or times of scarcity over times of abundance, because he kind of saw them both, and he welcomed everybody into the kingdom of God where their life could be made more rich. And he did that with the rich as well as the poor equally, but he did kind of warn them to say, don't let wealth get you off track. It can create a harder situation for you to find the kingdom of God. And I think we could all kind of relate with that. As much as we might think winning the lottery would be absolutely awesome, that Powerball come home with $168 million or whatever it is right now, I think that's a really cool idea. There would be a lot of playing that happened right after that win happened. But I think long-term, it's a complicated situation. There's a book out about lottery winners and how it wrecked their lives. And so there's also some some challenges that would probably come with it. Sports Illustrated, you all know I like my sports, and we're coming up on the end of NFL, so I got to grab my moments when I can. Sports Illustrated in 2009 did a study of NFL and NBA athletes and found that 78% of them were broke within 3 to 5 years of retiring. And these are guys that are making millions, and it really didn't matter how much they got paid or how long their career was. But there was an abundance that happened, but they didn't know how to navigate it well. And as a result, they found themselves in scarcity. So as we kind of go through some scriptures, I think we're going to get some tips on how we can navigate the abundance, whatever shape it takes in our lives, well, so that we can partner with the Lord and see what he wants to do. And so we're going to look at three scriptures. I was going to look at just one and go deep in it, but I decided to be a little more topical this time. We're going to look at Genesis 14, where Abram, as he was called, he later became Abraham, rescues his nephew Lot. And we're going to look at Luke 12, which is Dave Doherty's favorite parable, I believe. And then we'll also look at Revelation 3, so if you feel like thumbing in your Bible or something. But let me start with just reading the story of Abram rescuing his nephew Lot, and then we'll pray. Sorry, losing my voice here. So we're going to look at verses 14 through 24. It says, when Abram heard that his relative had been taken captive, he called out the 318 trained men born in his household and went in pursuit as far as Dan. And during the night, Abram divided his men to attack them, and he routed them, pursuing them as far as Hobah, north of Damascus. And he recovered all the goods and brought back his relative Lot and his possessions together with the women and the other people. By the way, at this point, he had rescued Lot, but found himself with all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah, two cities worth of people and goods that he had rescued. And after Abram returned from defeating Chedorlaomer and the kings allied with him, the king of Sodom came out to meet him in the Valley of Sheba, that is the Valley of Kings. And then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine, and he was a priest of God the Most High, and he blessed Abram, saying, blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand. And then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. And the king of Sodom said to Abram, give me the people and keep the goods for yourself. But Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have raised my hand to the Lord God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and have taken an oath that I will accept nothing belonging to you, not even a thread or a thong of a sandal, so that you may never be able to say, I made Abram rich. I will accept nothing but what my men have eaten and the share that belongs to the other men who were with me, to Aner, Eshel, and Mamre. Let them have their share. Let's pray. God, as we come just before your word, we want to hear from you. We have open hearts, and we want to be people who reflect you, who have an abundant life, and who live life well. May we be people who love you and love other people well. So guide us. Guide us as you have for thousands of years, people who have turned to you. We love you. In that passage we just read, I don't think Abram set out to get rich. He didn't see this raid happen to his relative and think now's a great time to acquire a lot. He was concerned about his nephew, and so he wanted to do something about it. And it was actually pretty foolish probably to take 300 people and to go attack two different kings in the middle of a war, but God blessed him, and he suddenly found himself sitting there with a lot. I can think of times that God has blessed Christina and I, or you, where you may have looked around and been like, wow, look at this place that God has brought me. I have a lot. And it's at that crucial moment that one of the most intriguing people of scripture sort of just pops up out of the middle of nowhere, and you don't expect him, and he's a guy with the coolest name, Melchizedek. which is hard to say with little kids especially because they come up with all sorts of variations of it. But Melchizedek shows up. We don't even know who he is, and then he disappears. We never hear from him again in Scripture. But he's a priest of God Most High. And I found it very interesting, the things that he says to him. Verse 19, he says, "Blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth." And that's sort of the starting place for what do we do with recognition of what we have. He says, God created this. God created heaven and earth. And so what you have, God made it all. He's the giver of every perfect gift. I want to read for you Colossians. It's a fantastic way of expressing it. Colossians 1, 16 and 17 says, "For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, thrones or powers or rulers or authority. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together." Now, what that's saying is that God made everything and he's holding it all together, and that if it wasn't for what he has done, we don't have much. He's holding all things together. And whether we recognize it or not, he has given us everything. Your personality, your life, your breath. And without his sustaining it, we don't keep going. And so there's this tendency within us, especially when we achieve something, or to go, "Man, look what I did." And it's easy to forget that it is God who has given us all that we have. He put us with the people he put us with. He gave us our life and has shaped our lives. And so the first tip for handling abundance is to recognize, where did this come from? And to recognize it's a gift from God. The other thing that Melchizedek says that's fantastic is he says, "Praise be to God who delivered your enemies unto you." Give the credit where the credit is due. If God created us and he gave it to us, who gets the credit for it? And I love that passage that I just read, that we are created for him. And when we bring our life in concert with God, when we recognize that it's him who gave us what we have, and then we give him the credit for it, things get in tune. Like if the guitarists were up there playing and they never tuned their instruments, it would feel a little off. There's a little bit of dissonance, and it gets a little, you start to do this as you listen to things, and it feels off. And I think our lives get like that, but as we bring them into concert with God, our lives begin to flow really, really beautifully. And this is God's invitation. It's not God trying to take something from us, or to steal your achievements, or to minimize us. That's not the story. The story is God saying, bring your life in concert with me so that you can appreciate how I've made it to be. And part of that is recognizing that God has given us all that we have. So Abraham's response was actually the very first example of tithing. It was going, "Well, God, you gave me everything, so I'm going to give some back to you." And it brings up the question of why give? Why bless other people? Why give back to God at all? And a part of that is that in the process of giving, we kind of break this cycle of needing to accumulate, and we realize that we are actually blessed right now. My sister came up for Christmas, and my family did something weird this year. We decided not to really give each other presents unless we saw something that we thought was like, "Oh, that's the perfect thing." But before, it was kind of like a big obligation. Every family member you have to get a present for. And we just decided not to do that this year. But instead, my sister came up, and we went to Mary's Place, which is a nonprofit that helps out families in need, and said, what can we do? And they go, "Oh, we have this thing that we're doing, and it's build a stocking for a family in need." And so we all went to the store, and we got a bunch of stuff that families in need would need that they had told us. And we built stockings for them, and it was the funnest thing to do. And it's sort of like one of those things that some people do around Thanksgiving. You like maybe go help out at a food kitchen or something. And you do that in part to help somebody, but also in part because it reminds you that you have been blessed with a lot. And it was so freeing to have Christmas not be about, am I going to get the stuff on my list? It's not about accumulating, but instead, we're going to bless some people. The other thing that doing this did with Abraham, and you get it in that last part where he says, I'm not going to be a person who says, you've made me rich, is it's going to be God who blesses me. And so when we give back to God, when we bless other people, it makes God a partner in what we're doing. And we let our lives come from God. And we find ourselves blessed. It reminds me of where Jesus talks about the vine and the branches. He says, you know, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So don't go off and just imagine that I'm not there, because you're going to have a hard time having me work in your life if that happens. So that's the starting point. Recognize that it's God who gives, and then respond. I want to read for you I love giving credit to you for this parable. Dave brings this parable up a lot, and I like it. It's Luke 12, 13 through 21. It's the parable of the rich fool, a title that does not mince words at all. And I love Jesus for his bluntness sometimes, and this is a little blunt. Here's the situation. Someone in the crowd, as Jesus was talking, said to him, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. One brother was taking too much of the inheritance, and they wanted Jesus to step in. And Jesus replied, Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbitrator between you guys? And then he said to them, Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life doesn't consist in the abundance of his possessions. And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man produced a really good crop. And he thought to himself, What should I do? I have no place to store these crops. And then he said, This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to tear down my barns and I'm going to build even bigger ones. And then I can store all my grain and all my goods. And I'll say to myself, You have so many good things laid up for many, many years. Now you can take life easy. Eat and drink and be merry. But God said to him, You fool. This very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you've prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with anybody who stores up things for themselves but is not rich towards God. There's a particular piece of that Jesus is warning against, and I have a tendency to hear Jesus not as just trying to like smack people down for doing wrong things, because I don't think that's his heart. It's not who he was with people. But he's trying to warn them, don't go down this wrong road. And one of the wrong roads that we can go down is, I'm going to accumulate a lot. I'm going to focus on accumulating now. And then maybe later when I get a lot of good stuff, then I can do something worthwhile with it. I think that's actually kind of how I think about if I won the lottery. If I won the lottery, well, then I could set up like a foundation, and I would help this, and I would help that, and I could change this. But until then, I can't really do much. As opposed to, well, what can I do now, in here, and for the people around me? And Jesus is saying, keep your life on target as you go. If any of you are Star Wars nerds, you can appreciate this little reference in Empire Strikes Back. They're going in to this channel to go blow up the Death Star and save the universe, more or less. One of the pilots is flying down into this channel, and there's all these things going on. There's things blasting at him, and there's ships behind him, and he's going, I'm not able to do this, I'm not able. And his squad leader goes, stay on target, stay on target. And I think that's what Jesus is saying here, is like, stay on target with your life, no matter what God is giving you. And it's crucial, and it's the tiniest little adjustment that can get us off track and take us in a whole other direction. My brother had this thing on his fridge, and he had all these pictures of like him with his family, like of a family sitting together on a beach and of a big yacht and some other stuff. And they were really good things. And he kind of said, I need to focus on getting these things so that later on I can spend time with my kids. That hasn't worked out well in the long haul. He's made some adjustments, thankfully, since then. But you can imagine where that leads. In 1979, there was this jet that took off with 257 people, and it was a sightseeing thing for Antarctica. It was a way to go see Antarctica. Not too many people had seen it. And they set off on their course, but they were 2 degrees off. And 2 degrees doesn't seem like much. But as they flew to Antarctica, by the time they reached their destination, where they were going to do a loop and see Antarctica and then fly back, they were 28 miles off course. And they didn't even realize it, but they were headed straight for a mountain, Mount Erebus, which is an active volcano. But everything was white, so no one could tell, and so it all just kind of looked like flat ground. And by the time the warning lights went off, they had gotten too far off track, and the plane crashed. It was one of the worst disasters up to that point. It killed everybody on board. Just a minor error of location. And so, by the grace of God, we get to make adjustments all the time. And one of the adjustments that we have is to stay on target. And Jesus says, at the end of that parable of the rich fool, this is how it'll be for anyone who stores up things for himself but is not rich towards God. I'm going to parse that very, very carefully. It's not anyone who has things. It's not an anti-abundance verse. It's anybody who is not rich toward God in the process of what they have. One of the coolest families that I met while I was a camp counselor at Sammamish Bible Camp. This really nice lady, she was really good at sharing the gospel with kids, and all of us were there, and we weren't making hardly anything and working very long hours. And I got to know this person, and she said, well, why don't you come over for dinner with my family? And that was a huge thing, because we were eating camp food. If you've ever tried to live off of like chicken nuggets and corn dogs, a home-cooked meal was a very, very welcome invitation. And so, went over, I said, yeah, that'd be great. And I'm noticing as we're driving to her house that we are driving down out of the city and getting closer and closer to the lake. And we pull up at this mansion on Lake Washington, like right on the shore. So it was a beautiful place. And I was duly impressed because I was a poor college student and I drove a 1976 Honda Civic, which was created 3 years after I was born. And so it was already 20 years old. And I never got a speeding ticket in it because I think it was actually impossible for me to get a speeding ticket. So we pull up to this house, but the more time I spent with this family, the more I realized that just wasn't who they were. They were people who were rich towards God, who happened to have a lot. And I think what God is challenging us with is, can we be people who are rich towards Him, however much we have, in whatever situation we find ourselves? Because that's a life that's on target. I'm probably going to show my age a little bit, but there used to be a bumper sticker that you'd always see, and I felt like I usually saw it on the back of like Beamers, and it said, he who dies with the most toys wins. And I always thought that's weird, because I figure he who dies with the most toys dies. And that's kind of the point of this. Well, what are you going to do with all this stuff? You have a huge barn and lots of stuff laid up. Now what are you going to do with it? So don't waste your life. What do you want your life to be about now? That's the question. What do you want your, I don't know, legacy to be? When I was doing college ministry, one of the first things we did with the interns is we go off to, we go to a graveyard, and we go look at headstones for a while. And then we'd invite them back to a group and we go, what do you want to be known for? After college, after whatever, after this season that you're in, what do you want to be known for? What do you want your life to be about? And it was just sort of a perspective, like, where are you headed sort of thing. I think about the Nobel Peace Prize, like the Nobel Prize, the foremost of which is the Peace Prize. That was created by Alfred Nobel, who had invented dynamite. He could have gone down in history as an incredibly wealthy man who invented dynamite. And instead, and this is kind of funny, most people didn't even know this, that it was in his will that he set aside the idea of giving away most of his wealth to people who had contributed a great deal to society. And thus the Nobel Prizes for all sorts of things were created. And a lot of people give credit to his wife for encouraging him to set up the Nobel Peace Prize. Maybe a more contemporary example, Bill Gates. Bill Gates could have gone down in history as a guy who's really smart and weird. He's weird. But created really cool computers that we all know and love and use. And he got ridiculously wealthy doing this. And at some point, he switched his focus to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and began to try to tackle problems in the world that he could tackle that looked like new challenges instead of how can I make the next version of Windows even better. It was, I wonder if I can tackle malaria. That seems doable. Let's try to stop anybody from dying from malaria now. And I remember sitting there in a class in seminary, in missions class, where we were looking at problems in the world and things, and we were looking at deaths by malaria. And the thing kind of was going like this, like the line that showed the number of deaths by malaria. And all of a sudden there's this like cliff where it drops off and then it's still there. But it dropped dramatically by like millions and millions. And I asked our professor, how did that happen? And she goes, oh, that's when the Gates Foundation decided to tackle malaria in Africa. And about buying nets and giving them to people who needed them. Now, I don't have the resources, nor probably do you, to tackle malaria in Africa. But what if we were people who were actually available to tackle the needs around us, the stuff that gets you passionate, the stuff that you want to post on Facebook, somebody should do something about this, or whatnot, where we go, we're going to do something for somebody that we can with what we have. It's a very simple idea that is so incredibly powerful, and it keeps our life track. One more passage we're going to look at. Revelation chapter 3. In Revelation, John is sharing from Jesus a number of letters to different churches in different places, and I feel like this letter to the Church of Laodicea gets quoted a lot, but I think there's a good reason for it. I think it's a letter to warn American Christians in particular of some stuff. And so anyways, let me read this letter. It says, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds. I know that you're neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. But because you are lukewarm, you're neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. You say I'm rich. I've acquired wealth. I don't need a thing. But you don't realize that you're wretched and pitiful and poor and blind and naked. So I counsel you, I advise you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can be rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so that you can see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone would hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. The American dream is to have more than enough to tackle anything that life throws at us. I used to live in Mill Creek, and I especially felt that in suburbia. The idea of having enough that I never have to borrow from a neighbor, that I never have to talk to my neighbors, and that I can completely manage all of my needs without ever interacting with somebody else was the definition of what it meant to succeed. I have enough. Oh no, I don't need any help in any way. And the goal within that is to lose dependence. And I think often that there is a temptation to lose dependence on God and on other people, and that that's a sign of being wealthy, to have enough, financially or otherwise. It's so hard to ask for help. It's great to give help. Everybody loves to give help. Oh yeah, sure, I'd love to help you, because that shows even more how much I have, that I can help you and still have enough for myself. But asking for help, it's harder. And this passage says, you don't even realize that that's an illusion of safety and impressiveness that you have. It's not impressive to have a lukewarm, comfortable life. The other thing that's tempting within abundance is to make ourselves safe and comfortable. No risks, no reaching out. And we're under control, we've got it. And Laodicea was a commerce center. It was a very impressive commerce center. And they were known for having plenty of wealth. They had lots of gold. And God says, I got something better than gold for you. How about you buy my gold? It's even better. And then that part about the clothes, they made white wool there. And everybody wanted Laodicean wool because it was so white. And then God says, no, I have something even whiter. You can get white garments from me that will cover you. And then there's this beautiful invitation. Invite me in. I'm standing at your door. I'm knocking. I want to come into your life. Invite me in and purchase even better stuff than you think you have from me. It's not all that complicated. Love God, love other people well, and you will find yourself with a rich life that cannot be bought. Most of the stuff that doesn't matter, or that matters the most, is not purchasable. And I don't want to be someone who figures that out as I sit on my deathbed and go, man, I have a large number piled up in a bank account somewhere. That's cool. Rich. I want to have a rich life. And that's found in investing in the people around us and investing in God. I want to be an abundant person. And maybe I've had it the wrong way. Maybe it's not about piling up enough stuff to be comfortable and safe. Maybe it's about investing in the right things, keeping our life on track, and giving credit where credit is due. I've told you guys about my new adventure. I have a weird off the beaten path work where I like to just be a weird person and a little bit of a nerd. And so I decided to take up curling because that sounded nerdy and weird. And you're all like, yep, it is. No, but I am officially the 500th member of the Granite Curling Club, which is located nearby. And but as I've gone in, I'm completely foreign to this experiment. I like to be in control. I like to know what I'm doing, and I like to study so that I know what I'm doing and not feel insecure. And now I'm sliding around on ice, trying to not fall over a lot. And I'm as new as can be. And what I found is a bunch of people at this club who go, you know what? I'm rich in curling. I've been doing it for 25 years now. And these old ladies, and they go, how do you try this? And one guy goes, you just don't take this the wrong way, but you look so awkward doing this. Do you mind if I help you for a little bit? I'm like, please, because this hurts. But what if we did life that way? What if we actually, out of whatever abundance we have, the abundance of our life experiences, the abundance of the generosity God has shown to us, the abundance of the resources, the talents, friendships that we can extend to people, we go, I just want to come alongside and help you out. And where I need it, I'm going to need y'all to help me out. And I want to be rich towards God and love other people. I think that might even be better than having a ton of stuff. So, that happens now. We start shaping our lives. That's what the series is about. And it can happen this week. All those passages talked about being rich towards God, not just rich. So let's go try and do that. Sound good?
Yeah.
All right. Let's pray. God, thanks for taking good care of us. We're all here because you have, and you're holding us together, and the world hasn't flamed out because you have taken care of us and provided for us. We give you recognition, and we thank you for that. Lord, help us to live rich, full lives. Help us to be in tune with you and to love you and love other people. God, make us better than just having a lot of stuff. That's such a small dream. We want your dreams, your big dreams of being people who love well. So, guide us this week.